Recent earthquakes and aftershocks have devastated the island of Puerto Rico. But what's causing them and what does the future hold? I sat down with Jack Loveless, Smith College Associate Professor of Geosciences, to find out more.
Puerto Rico is in a tectonically active area where some of the world's tectonic plates are meeting. So every earthquake in the world happens on a fault, and the boundary between tectonic plates are the world's largest faults, where earthquakes are going to happen most commonly. So Puerto Rico is in a pretty complicated place where the North American tectonic plate is interacting with the Caribbean tectonic plate. And so every once in a while, you're going to have a release of energy, and that's what an earthquake actually is. The energy gets stored up as a result of these tectonic plates interacting with each other, and then eventually gets released.
In terms of the pattern of the way the earthquakes are happening, though, as I understand it, it's a little bit different. We might typically expect a large earthquake and then a series of aftershocks, but that isn't exactly what's been happening in Puerto Rico, right?
Right. It all started around the latest of December, I think the December 29th, with a magnitude 4.7. And it started a whole sequence of events, which of course has culminated in the magnitude 6.4 and its own aftershock sequence. Again, none of these earthquakes is necessarily unexpected on its own, given the tectonic activity of the area. What has been interesting is the fact that we now see that there was what we call a foreshock sequence before that magnitude 6.4 happened.
And what does that mean, a foreshock sequence?
Well, it's sort of similar to an aftershock in that really maybe we could just think of it as a nomenclature. That is, a foreshock, we can only call an earthquake a foreshock once a larger earthquake happens relatively close by, both in space and time. Mm. The same way that after a major earthquake, we often see an aftershock sequence that is a series of smaller earthquakes that occur in the days to weeks to even months or years following that event.
So in terms of when you hear more than 900 since December 31st, is this just something that's not commonly reported and has been going on right along, or is this something new and different happening in Puerto Rico?
Well, truly, in terms of the number that have been happening, those would all fall under the category of aftershocks. Many of those earthquakes are going to be too small to be felt, even in the immediate vicinity where they're occurring. There have been several noticeable aftershocks in about the magnitude 5 range. Those have the potential certainly to be widely felt and sometimes have the potential to do additional damage. Again, in terms of the raw numbers, this is an expected aftershock sequence following that largest magnitude 6.4 event.
It's perhaps just compounded by the fact that Puerto Rico is still struggling to recover from Hurricane Maria and has lots of infrastructure challenges as a result of that. And now you add this to that, it's just compounding the situation, I would imagine.
Exactly. I think the very weak electrical grid that has been essentially under repair since the occurrence of those hurricanes was all the more fragile and therefore susceptible to a lot of damage with this earthquake.
I was looking at some of the U.S. Geological Survey's information, and they track, obviously, earthquakes across the world. When I looked for Puerto Rico, there were three total in 2019 that were considered significant, which is a larger number earthquake. And when we look at 2020, so far, we've already had three what's considered significant earthquakes by USGS. So we've had a 6.4 that we've talked about, a 5.8, and a 5.6. In terms of the magnitude that we have seen so far this year compared to last year, is that unusual or kind of more of the same for what we expect for this region?
Well, I think with earthquakes anywhere in the world, we don't necessarily have an expectation that they will occur with any given rate in a given year. We can talk about global averages or even average rates of occurrence even within a particular region. But every once in a while, there is an anomalous earthquake, a particularly strong release of energy. Oftentimes, the release of this energy, it may take years to decades, even centuries, to accumulate to a level where it then needs to be released. And we don't have a way of knowing exactly when that will happen, or in other words, in which year a particularly strong earthquake will happen.
So in that regard, it's a relatively inexact science within this area of study.
Right. Earthquakes are so far, they are unpredictable. And we don't have a lot of information about any particular patterns that may lead us to believe an earthquake is going to happen. It's a little bit different when we talk about these aftershocks. The U.S. Geological Survey will post various aftershock forecasts for the next week or so, given their statistical expectation of the types of earthquakes that may occur.
And so those forecasts, are they sort of similar in nature, and stick with me here for a minute, similar in nature to a weather forecast, where it's kind of our suspicion, but really we know the weather forecast changes quite often very quickly. Is it similar with that type of forecasting for the USGS?
To some extent. So primarily it's based on statistical collection of when and where earthquakes have happened. For example, the USGS aftershock forecasts currently say that it's most likely that we'll have some continued smaller magnitude earthquakes in the next week or so, although there is a very small outside chance that an even larger earthquake could be triggered by this event. Again, we're talking about very small probabilities of that particular occurrence, but it's not out of the realm of possibility.
Yeah, I think I read 3% chance when you talk about small probability, just to kind of quantify it for folks.
Right.
In terms of where we go from here, what will you be watching and listening for around this issue?
Well, it'll be interesting to continue to watch the pattern of aftershocks that happen in the next weeks and actually see how long that sequence lasts overall. It might also be interesting to see if any other earthquakes in other parts of Puerto Rico, whether it's off the north coast as opposed to off the south coast as this earthquake was, whether earthquakes in a slightly different location also occur in the next couple weeks to months.
I was reading somewhere that the tectonic plates that Puerto Rico is situated on are similar to the Pacific Rim in nature. Is that correct? And do we know if there's similar activity happening there? Can it be compared, or is that just a completely inaccurate thing to think about comparing?
No, I think we can think about really any pair of tectonic plates. Where they meet, that is a place where earthquakes are going to be most likely to occur. The type of actual motion that happens around Puerto Rico is actually a little bit strange, and it is different from what's happening, for example, on the west coast of the United States. In that case, we have what we could think of as purely horizontal motion parallel to the surface of the Earth, whereas in Puerto Rico, we actually have one plate, the North American plate, diving underneath the island of Puerto Rico. And so there's some differences in terms of the details of how these tectonic plates are moving in relation to each other, but there are certainly some similarities in that we have active plate tectonic boundaries, both in Puerto Rico and along the west coast of the U.S.